As readers, students, parents, or teachers, most of us would remember the haunting imagery that leaped out of the poems on killing a tree, or how do you withstand body, which form part of the literature syllabi designed to stir our finer sensibilities. We might also remember having read that the writer was also a painter and a doctor, and wondered at the many faceted talents that were housed behind the name Gieve Patel. Little did we know then that one day we would be privileged, thanks to the Lalit Kala Academy, of not just seeing the person, but actually listening to him and viewing his artworks. This Mumbaikar was born in the 40s and received training in the manner of most typical, intelligent, hardworking sons of Indian parents as a medical student at Grant Medical College. But while most would content themselves with a flourishing medical practice, Gieve Patel refused to let that be his be-all and end-all, and chose to wield not just the scalpel, but also the brush, the chisel, and the pen. He held his first art show in Mumbai in 1966, and went on to have several major exhibitions in India and abroad. He participated in the Menton Biennale, France, in 1976, and in the 80s in exhibitions at Oxford and the Royal Academy, London, Gray Art Gallery, New York, Worcester Art Museum, Massachusetts, as well as in Geneva. His paintings are in public and private collections, including the National Gallery of Modern Art, New Delhi, Bharat Bhavan, Bhopal, the Jehangir collection at the Prince of Wales Museum, Mumbai, the Museum of Modern Art in France, and the Peabody Essex Museum in USA. Gieve Patel has been a writer in residence at the University of Pennsylvania. He was also awarded the Rockefeller Fellowship, University of Chicago, and the Woodrow Wilson Fellowship at the Smithsonian Institution, Washington, D.C. Patel's poems have been published in independent collections, notably Mirrored, Mirroring, and in numerous anthologies of contemporary poetry. He's also penned three plays. A self-taught artist, Gieve Patel's works resonate with empathy for the oppressed and downtrodden, questioning the existential condition. Both his writings and paintings evince an acute consciousness of ordinary people, often set within crowded cityscapes, going about their quotidian lives. Thus, they may be part of a shipbuilder's community, workers taking a breather from the day's labors, or a migrant dictating a letter home. Through depiction of postures, stances, and clothing of the body, or even through sculpted hands and heads, the artist offers a telling comment on the human condition.
Thank you, Devan. For inviting me here to this beautiful city and this lovely space, this gracious audience. I've been walking around near the lake a lot, and just absolutely delightful. I think I'll dream of it when I go to Bombay. I've titled this talk, The Brush and the Eye. So I think that the first set of works which I'll show you will more or less illustrate why, and then we'll get on from there. I just want to make a few preliminary statements. The painter looks at the external world very, very sharply and consistently with his physical eyes. And that's the cornerstone with which he works. I think that a painter looks more sharply, more passionately than most people do, because that is how he obtains so much of his material. But there's another eye with which he looks, which is the inner eye, and often what the inner eye tells him contradicts what his external eye is telling him. And works can show a process of conflict between the two ways of seeing, or he might prefer the external eyes account, he might prefer the inner eyes account. So these are various ways in which the artist interacts with the world, which is why the title. I'll say a few words about the first set of works, which are the clouds, before we see the images. You know, I live in Bombay, and in Bombay, between the months of June and September, our skies are full of clouds. You know, we have the monsoon. And quite literally, the skies become a kind of a theater. We have an absolute procession and a variety of clouds between these months. And all my life I have been immensely interested in looking at these moving processions. And at some point a few years ago, I said to myself, would it be possible for me to put this down as an artwork, you know, as one of my creations, how and what these clouds mean to me. Since they mean so much, let me try and articulate them in my own way. So the first thought that came to me, like, you know, what does one do with clouds? You know, you see clouds as masses moving. The first idea would be to take ink and water and a brush and dip your brush and create masses. And I very, very quickly rejected this idea. You know, it just seemed completely wrong to me. It was not what I was looking for. So I had to puzzle a little more about this. And then I had to allow my instinct to take over, which is again a point which I will come to again and again in the talk, which is that I'm going to talk to you today about my work, and I'm going to give you explanations and interpretations. But please remember that all explanations and interpretations come after the work has been done. The work itself is done from a combination of outer observation, inner observation, and intuition. After the work has been done, or somewhere in the process in between, you begin, you know, it's a normal human need. You begin to ask yourself, why am I doing this, like that? You know, what is driving me to portray it quite in this way? And that is where interpretation begins. So interpretation comes later, but when I'm giving a talk to you, I have to sometimes give you the interpretation face on. But just remember that it comes much later in the process. So my intuition, my instinct led me to take pencils of various densities and or a Croquel pen and an ink. A Croquel nib is a very special kind of a nib. It's very delicate, difficult to manipulate because it keeps dropping big drop blobs of ink on the paper, and you have to keep again and again dipping it in the inkwell. But if you learn to use it, it can give you very exquisitely fine lines. And after you have used a particular nib for a long time, it can even give you thicker lines. So I started using this Croquel pen, and started making lines, individual lines. And the cloud drawings emerged by these individual lines on paper. And after I've shown you five or six of them, I'll tell you why I was happy with the result. All these drawings are small. The largest of them is imperial size, which is about 33 inches by 22 inches. Then they get small, some of them get smaller and smaller. There are some which are just about that tiny. Yes, please. You know, I was very happy with the result as I was working on them. I've got a collection now of about like 50 of these drawings, you know. And when I came to like about 15 or 20, I knew I was in the right direction. I was moving in the right direction. And this is a thought process that I went through. I said, what is it about these clouds that fascinates me? And what is special about clouds? What's special about clouds is that unlike every other thing on Earth, they don't have a final form. You look at an apple, or you look at a skull, you look at a sitter whose portrait you are doing, you know, you look at a tree, it's a final form there and the artist is addressing it. The cloud is in a continuous process of forming and dissolving at the same time. At the same moment, two things are going on in the cloud, which is why it has no final form. And that is the essential quality of the cloud that fascinated me. And I thought that this was the best way to capture it through linear means, you know, through lines which look like they are gelling together and pulling apart at the same time. So I will now just let you see a lot of images without talking about them. Yeah, this particular show was called Clouds, Skulls, and Wells. At the same time that I was working on the clouds, I did a set of about 7 drawings on the human skull, which is again a subject that, you know, I've always been fascinated by. When I first started painting, I did a set of works on the skull, and after almost like 35 years, I came back to the subject. But I think that something about the clouds has rubbed off on these skulls, and I feel quite happy about that. They for one thing, you know, they don't have a base, you'll notice. You don't see any table surface or a ground on which they are situated, which makes them look a little bit like they're floating. And I personally feel that they have some kind of a fellowship with the clouds in the way that they've been worked at too. I wouldn't want to push this too much, but there is a suggestion of it for me, and maybe transience is what was at the back of it, you know. These are also fairly small works, 30 inches by 22 inches. That's almost like, you know, it's almost disappearing, you know, like a cloud. This is a painting which is about, I've done a whole set of works since 1991. Which have a composite title, Looking into a Well. And this again goes back to a childhood experience, a boyhood experience. My people come from a small seaside village in Gujarat called Nargol, and one of my earliest activities there was, of course, you know, running around, you know, peeping into every well we passed by. Now, these Gujarat wells are nothing like the grand step wells that, you know, are so celebrated. These are humble little village wells, round, oval, and the water in the monsoon comes so high up that you could lean over the surface of the well and touch the surface of the water. The practice of looking into a well has remained with me ever since. I never can pass by a well without looking in, even today. But at the age of 51 in 1991, I told myself, if this little experience is so important to you, do you think that you could do a painting on it? And I attempted painting. Now, one of the most interesting technical problems is that the experience is you standing at the edge of a well looking down. If you want to make a painting of this, the painting, remember, is standing on the surface of a wall. So you're translating the experience of looking down into one of looking straight ahead, you know? So that's one technical problem which had to be dealt with. The other technical problem was that most people, when they portray a cylindrical space going downwards, they make it into something vertiginous, you know, something that sucks you in. Whereas for me, the experience is a joyful one and is not contaminated with fear and dread. So the idea of making something vertiginous was foreign to me. So my wells had to be on a flat wall surface, and they had to be portrayed in such a way that they are not vertiginous, with the result that many people who have seen these paintings often say that they are not sure whether they are looking down into a well. They could actually be standing at the bottom of the well and looking up at the sky. And this ambiguity is something that I'm very comfortable with. So this is one example of one of the later wells. Each of these wells is a separate and distinct experience, so that none of them, to me, is a repetitive thing. They're not formal exercises. So like saying, you know, that like, I've got the circumference of the well, I've got the sides with the vegetation, I've got what's outside the well, and the reflection on the water surface, the depths of the well. Now I make variations on it. It's not like that. These are not variations. To me, each one is quite literally a distinct and separate personality. In order to give a structure to my talk, at some point, not this talk, because I've been giving talks of this kind, you know, around the country, so not just this talk alone, I discovered for myself, post-work, that broadly speaking, I tend to be doing three kinds of things. One is a set of works which you might call human beings going about their everyday experiences, you know, most often in the city, sometimes in the countryside. So it is like the human figure in an environment, which could be urban or rural. Then I have a set of works which deal with death and decay. So these could be pictures of dying people, dying animals, violent deaths, and so on. And the third are the wells, which I might broadly call celebratory works, works which are leaping up from the earth, you know, so to speak. I'd also like to say something in passing about these wells, or maybe I'll talk about it when we come to more of them. Okay, next please. So that's a hanged man. So one example from the set of works on violent death, a small work again, and the third is a gypsy who's stringing a musical instrument. So the painting is called Ektara. I'd also like to tell you that I'm not showing you these works chronologically. I'm not starting like, you know, I started like that, then this is the middle period, and now my most recent work, because that somehow doesn't interest me. I prefer to rearrange it, and so it's a surprise to me, you know, each time when I see works. And if it's a surprise to me, then hopefully it's a surprise to you as well. So I'm going to show you a certain number of works which have to do with the human being in his various settings. This painting is called The Letter Home, and it's a laborer from Andhra Pradesh on the left who's come to Bombay to make buildings, and he wants to send a letter to his family. He's illiterate, so he dictates the letter to his to the scribe for a fee, something that you see on the streets of Bombay quite frequently. And I was interested in the contrast of literacy and illiteracy, the fact that although the employer is going to pay money for the job, he himself looks bewildered and unconfident, whereas a scribe with the, you know, power of knowledge and literacy is spreading himself out and, you know, full of confidence in his intellectual powers, and with a little bit of a cityscape behind. Yep. Some details. This painting is called Gateway. It's like about almost 10 feet, 11 feet horizontally, and about four vertically, four and a half. The drama of this painting for me is the distance between the two characters and the tension that prevails for that reason. You know, if you place, you know, two kind of electrodes, so to speak, at two ends of a space, and there's something going on between them, they both vibrate. What's going on between them is a mystery. We don't know. And you know, that also is part of the content of the work. They are street people, as you can see, you know, and what is going on between them is some contentious issue, right? And again, what interests me in the painting is the fact that there's a third character in it, and that character is the Gateway of India. In colors, you know, which it never had. The Gateway of India is a kind of a big gazebo for me. We played under the Gateway when we were kids. So it is a bit of a fairy tale structure, which is possibly why it is so multicolored. We have some details here. Next, please. There's a nice pothole in front of the man, you know, which is one of our favorite Bombay things, which has a broken flip-flop chappal and a coconut shell in it. Yep. Madman on the street is again a subject which, you know, recurs in my work. I have two or three versions of it. Painter friend of mine renamed the painting for me. He said, we'll call it The Swaying Saint. By this time, I think you'll have noticed that almost all the paintings I work with are outdoors, you know, and they tend to be marginalized people, street people. None of them are in a sitting room, you know, none of them are in a bedroom, in a flat. And I have to confess again, you know, that I don't know why that is the case. Maybe this is what interests me more. That's about what I can say. Yes, please. Weeping Woman, again, a theme which comes again and again. Now, among my favorite paintings, you know, of all time, I have two versions of the Weeping Woman. One is Picasso's Weeping Woman, which is a jagged, a painting of great turmoil, you know. She's got a handkerchief in her mouth, and she's obviously sobbing away, and the whole painting is in kind of in fragments, and it is so graphic that you feel almost that you can see the mucus in her nose, you know. It's that kind of physicality the painting has in the act of weeping. And the other painting, you know, in a very contrasted painting, is the painting of the Madonna, the weeping Madonna, in Rogier van der Weyden's painting of Deposition from the Cross, which is a 14th century Flemish painting, where the Madonna, the figure of Mary, the face, is in utter repose. And there's one pearl-like tear coming down her cheek, you know? And yet, it is as poignant as the Picasso painting, you know? It is as full of sorrow and of depth of emotion, of passion. So, drawn to these two contrasted works, I told myself, what's your weeping woman like? And which is why I took a shot at it. Tears are very difficult to paint, but I've got a few there. Again, a painter friend of mine, you know, painters, whatever they say about your work is always very useful. He said to me, she looks like a potato. And if I hadn't been quite certain that he actually liked the painting very much, I'd have felt very disturbed. So then we explored a little bit, you know, about why he was saying this and what he meant. And he said, her face is like a tuber, you know. It's like something that's come out of the bowels of the earth, you know, something that grows inside the earth. And they've been brought up and it's been put against the clouds and the skies. And that is what he found interesting in the painting. You know, I always find whatever remarks other painters make about your work very, very eloquent, you know. And they're sometimes very strange. They're the kind of remarks that you know, people who are not painters will not make, you know. People who are writers will make completely different kinds of remarks. So one gets wonderful kinds of feedback from the environment around one. Yeah. Off Lamington Road, it's a very large painting again, and the only work I've done where there's something like 30 human beings and four or five goats, one horse, one dog. It's just Bombay Street. It was done after a visit to Italy, where I was seeing crucifixion after crucifixion, and they're all wonderful, great crucifixions. But I noticed that in many of them, at the foot of the cross, there is a bizarre crowd of Italians who've come out to see the spectacle of the crucifixion. And the Italian painters have painted these everyday human beings at the foot of the cross with tremendous observation and interest. So when I came back here, I didn't want to do the cross, but I did want that crowd at the foot of the cross, which is what I got.
Which year is this?
This painting was done over a period of about 4 years, say from 82 to 86, something like that. And again, the amazing quality of Bombay street life, you know, is something that I wanted to explore here. For instance, in the middle, in the center of the painting, you have the Lambretta with a young man, a child, and a woman, you know, having a pleasant, almost domestic conversation between them. But right behind them, there's a chain of lepers walking past. And these these extraordinary contrasts are things that you come to again and again in Bombay life, you know. Yes, please. I have some details from this painting. Now, that's a mad woman on the street, abandoned by her family. It's again a theme, as I said, you know, which recurs. A small painting. It's called Riot. And when I completed the painting, I was not certain whether the boy was being cast into the flames or whether he was being rescued from the flames. And I allowed that ambiguity to remain. I was talking to you about, you know, what painters say to each other. There's a beautiful, wonderful story for me behind this, I think, which I would like to share with you. At the time that I was halfway through this work, the Mandal riots broke out. I think all of you will remember. There was this riots that took place because of the reservation of student seats. And a lot of young people set themselves on fire. And I was working on this painting, which depicted a young boy in the middle of a fire. And I felt extraordinarily upset, you know, as though in some way I were responsible for what was actually happening all around the country. And at that point, I phoned my friend Sudhir Patwardhan, who's a very close friend, a painter, as you all know, one of our best painters. And I said, Sudhir, I can't go on with this painting. I think I have to abandon it because I just feel too disturbed, you know. So he's very quiet, you know, and after a while he said, I think you should complete it. He said it very gently, but very firmly. And, you know, it was like a nudge. It was like, as though you're telling me that you should shoulder the full responsibility for being an artist. You know, don't chicken out. I mean, you know, what a valuable thing, you know, for a friend to say to one, you know. And so I, for what it was worth, finished the painting. Next. Figure in landscape. At one point I was doing Bombay railway platforms, and the structure on the left is something that would going to develop into a platform, a railway platform, but halfway through it seemed to have a beautiful futuristic kind of a presence, so I let it remain that way, and I put a Bombay Central porter at the other end of the painting. So a very traditional Maharashtrian porter interacting with this futuristic structure on the right, I thought that it kind of gave a nice vibration to the painting. Next. Yeah. Woman buying vegetables. Time in a painting, sometimes time functions in a painting. And in this case, for me, the time is the time taken for the dog to trot from the left of the painting to the right, which is something that in viewing this painting you will unconsciously include in your viewing. It's called Pink City, or it's called Two Men with Handcart. Behind the two men is a peeling wall. And I went to town with the peeling. As I kind of started working on the peeling, I got so fascinated by it that ultimately it became like a kind of a map of some completely, you know, fictitious territory. And it seemed just great to me, you know, that these two men, or laborers, and are talking about something probably very local and very personal should be put before a fictitious map. Also, you see the buildings, some of them are suggested, some of them are half completed. In many of my paintings, there comes a point where I feel that I would like to leave something unsaid or half said, and that it will speak more powerfully rather than were I to complete the statement. Next. This one is called Early Guest. I don't think I need to explain. there's a detail. In the late 60s and early 70s, I did a set of works which were taken, the images were taken from newspaper photographs. You know, at that time, our newspapers were full of photographs of decadent-looking politicians being garlanded with fresh, beautiful flowers, or receiving some wonderful document, or some rare book. This one is called Dead Politician. And I was interested in the freshness of the flowers, in contrast to the death on the face. Next, please. That's an etched version of the same subject. Folk festival. It shows Mrs. Gandhi on the left, holding a rosebud like a Mughal emperor, and a Rajasthani folk singer on the right, and a middle class woman who's probably organized the festival. And the reason this particular newspaper photograph fascinated me was that I said these three women wouldn't be seen dead anywhere in any other context except at a moment like this, which is for display for the newspaper photographer. Otherwise, the three worlds are so separate, so fragmented. To put them together like this itself, it becomes something potently interesting. Next. It's called Congratulations. Next. This is what I was talking about, railway platforms. Did a set of paintings. The most often local railway platforms of local trains in Bombay. And I was interested in the scrub fields on either side of the platform. And I've often been asked why there are no human beings in these paintings, because Indian railway stations are always full of human beings. My answer is very simple, actually. It's because there are certain moments in between trains where suddenly there's nobody there, or hardly anybody. And that is the moment when the station speaks out. The full poetry of the station, the architecture, the silence, the surrounding, becomes potent at that point. So I did several paintings on this subject. Yes. Yeah, that's near the railway tracks. I show you a whole lot of wells now, and you'll see what I mean when I say that each one is distinctively separate and different. And I think I'd like to now introduce this little thought. As I said, somewhere along the way, when I was painting, and I was asking myself, why am I doing this one painting after the one painting, and that it seems inexhaustible to me, When I started doing these, I thought I might do two, I might do three. But no, it's just going on and on and on. At a slow pace, but it is going on, and hopefully it will go on in the future. I think it's because, for me, somehow, the action of painting, looking into a well, becomes synonymous with looking into myself. And so then the whole thing acquires a density, which, you know, keeps the whole thing going on and on. The exploration can become endless. This is a well at night, with the full moon reflected in it. And here I'm going to show you a few examples of violent deaths. This is a drowned woman. These are small paintings, very small. You know the foam coming out of her nose and her mouth. You can imagine that in order to paint that, there's something very painstaking about it. It's like I'm dipping a very, very thin brush into thick white paint and making stipples and allowing them to dry and then adding on more, allowing them to dry and adding on more. It's a laborious and a quiet kind of a action. And this has something to do with addressing such a subject at all. Why would one address a subject like this? One is not obviously doing it for sensational reasons. One could do much worse. You're doing it because it is a kind of a yoga. It is a kind of a practice to confront violent death session after session, afternoon after afternoon, on that one painting, and to come to, you can't come to terms with it, but at least to come face to face with it, something like that. And so you'll find in some of the others also that there are many details, you know, which are very, very carefully and intentionally done, like in the next painting, the battered body in the landscape. You know, it's a very poetic landscape and a very violent death. And next, please. And in this detail, you will see that I've addressed various facets of the violence, like fat flowing out of the neck wound, blood oozing out, the scalp torn, and the hair, you know, behind the scalp, the jawbone. Now, this is not, you know, it's very strange. The thin line between enjoyment of something that is morbid and you might call it a philosophical wish to understand something. Very interesting comment again by a painter. He said the eyeball looks like the full moon coming out of clouds. Yeah, next. The crushed head. The head of a man crushed under a truck. All small works. Crows. This one is called Crows with Debris. The crows are obviously pecking at the remains of the little animal who's been run over by a car. You can see the track. But there are other kinds of debris around, like the fence at the top with the barbed wire, that's gone crazy. And lower left hand, there's again a slipper, a flip-flop slipper which is torn, and a used condom. It's the, in a way, a kind of the refuse of the city, you know, the things that the city throws out of its system, leaves behind, including the death of a pointless little animal. Next, please. These are a set of heads, some of them my patients, taken by from photographs which I myself have clicked. Some of them have been done from memory. They are small again, small works. The railway worker. Motor mechanic. That's an aging eunuch. This painting is called Peacock at Nariman Point. And it has an interesting story behind it. One day I opened the papers, newspapers, and I found this photograph, black and white, of course, in the Times of India. It was clicked by the Times photographer Hoshi Jal. And there was a little story behind it. It appears that one morning, the office boy of one of the skyscrapers at Nariman Point, he came to his office and was about to open the door before the people came into the office and cleaned the place, and he found a peacock standing in front of the door. So he phoned his boss, and the boss phoned the Times of India, and the Times of India sent Hoshi Jal. Hoshi Jal said to the office boy, pick up the peacock and stand in front of the Nariman Point skyline with the bay and the distant skyscrapers, and he clicked this picture. And I thought it was such an iconic picture that I should memorialize it in a painting, because never again will a peacock be found in a Nariman Point office. This peacock must have walked all the way from Malabar Hill, it's about like 4 miles, in the middle of the night, all across Marine Drive, and to the Nariman Point office. The other reason I painted this painting is because the history of our painting is so full of beautiful peacock paintings, but those paintings are all in Mughal gardens or Rajput gardens, never in front of a Nariman Point office. And I said that you know, this is a once in a thousand year moment. To paint a peacock in a completely modern setting was a great privilege. Next. It's called The Water Tank at Nargol, or Boy Bathing Buffaloes. It's a view round the trunk, the base of a tree, and with the roots going down. And, you know, round the trunk, you look down into the pond where the buffaloes are being bathed, and there's a water bird flying off from there. There's a Matisse painting in the Fine Arts Institute in Chicago. I love very much, and I had been to Chicago at that time, in which it's called Bathers, and Matisse has a huge painting with half or more than half of the painting just being a kind of a block of dark gray like that with some squiggles, which is a river. So half the painting is occupied by the river. And then on that little half, or less than half, are two or three bathing figures, you know. And I think I was haunted by this. So when I came back, I did this painting where half the painting is occupied by the tree trunk. When you do this, you know, you push the so-called important part of the painting into one corner and you dramatize it in that way. Lovers at Marine Drive. This is a called Girl. It's a girl in a municipal school uniform. She's very frail, very thin. Her hands and legs are like sticks, but she has terrific vitality. And, you know, I could only do that by putting her right in the center of a bleak cityscape. Man in the rain with bread and bananas. It's a massive August shower. And, you know, the man is, it's like his lifeblood. You know, preserving his lifeblood, you know. I have more versions of this. It's like when you are put into a position of sudden and extreme insecurity. You know, these showers in August come suddenly. You know, before you can open the umbrella, you're soaked through and through. And what do you do with your day's provisions? This is the interior of a train carriage. It's called early morning local in Bombay. The only time of the day, probably 5 a.m., when Bombay trains are not crowded, and you can get a bit of sleep in it. And, you know, again, it's the only interior I've done, but the interior is almost like an exterior, you know. It's sort of, you can see the window and the door on the left of the painting. I've done a few sculptures, and I go over them very quickly. These sculptures are on two themes, Ekalavya and Daphne. Ekalavya loses a thumb, which all of you know about. Daphne is from Greek mythology, and she is a forest nymph, a wood nymph, who is about to be raped by Apollo. And she prays to the forest gods to save her. And before, just as Apollo is about to get hold of her, she's transformed into a tree. So she escapes the rape, but her fate is tragic nevertheless. So these sculptures are, you know, show you the female body metamorphosing into a tree or a female head, you know, and I think they try to address the mixed, the escape and the tragedy. And of course the tragedy and the triumph of Ekalavya is something that, you know, is second knowledge to all of us. So I'll very quickly go over a few of these images. This is Daphne with a vegetation sprouting from her mouth. Madman in the Street is one more version of it. So one of the wells. This one is called The Sun Behind Clouds. I give little subtitles to the wells to give some indication. That's Morning Light. This one is a companion piece to the other crows who are pecking the dead bodies. This one is a crow with eggshell, which you can barely see. It looks like a moon in the sky. These are drawings which I did from newspaper photographs of women who had lost their sons and husbands in one of our repeated national tragedies. These drawings were done in 71. And years later, I did a set of paintings from it. So I'll show you the drawings and then the paintings. And they relate somewhat to the weeping woman. They're small, of course. Yeah, this is a set of paintings almost done 32 years later for using those drawings as source material. It's a triptych. Yeah, they're the individuals of the three individual works. These are fairly recent works, again small, done on board. They're called Four Meditations on Old Age. I wanted to approach the subject of old age in a way which is not very obvious, you know. We all know that we have to go through old age, and we all know that it's a difficult period. I'm myself approaching it. So it seemed to me something that needed to be addressed. I thought I want to address it frontally, without any mercy on myself or the human race. And so we have this. I'll have individual ones. The final vanity of having a black, a wig of black hair at this age. This is a new set of works that I'm working where, again, I'm taking pictures from the newspapers and removing a context. Like, you know, you get pictures of people with their mouths open or responding to something. If you take away the context of why they are doing it, then, you know, it becomes a mysterious moment. A moment which cannot be completely explained. This is again a fairly small work. It's called Man in the White Shirt. Yeah, and that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gieve ji. Wonderful, you know, how do I say, the eloquence of a poet and a painter. And the dramatist, so photo wala kahe aapko, you know, rang wala kahe ya theater wala kahe ya kavita wala ya whatever. We have quite a few of us in the fraternity who are so well versed with the spoken word, you know, like him, as we have K.G. Subramaniam ji, and we have Ghulam Ahmad Sheikh, then Krishan Khanna, and in the younger generation like Jitish Kallath and many others. But very few of them who are gifted with this kind of a, you know, kind of command over the language, to be able to speak with such an authority and in a poetic manner and in a very responsible, sensible manner that it doesn't take anything away from the work of art. The usage of the words is so appropriate and so well thought over that, as he says, he takes a few years to complete a work of art, or he, you know, there's a gestation period, you know, when he actually thinks about it for a few years. When you were talking about this during the interview, during the day, that he just, the editing is going on in his mind, you know, so he doesn't really need to. But it is such a wonderful experience of having seen the work and having heard you speak about the work. Only a poet and a painter probably could do it. No art critic or no writer probably could do that. But I'm nobody to pass a comment, and that is only a kind of a trigger which I'm kind of throwing to the public so that they got initiated into asking questions.
Thank you, Devan.
And some of the, you know, pictures, as you must have noticed, that his style of painting, you know, is so subtle, and sometimes so subtle and so straight. And it seems sometimes to me, I'm no critic, but if I'm wrong, please correct me. I think he's taking the expressionistic tradition forward in the uses of the color, the brush strokes, and the forms and the shapes. You know, it seems you have taken quantum jumps from there on to express this. Every little line of the stroke, it speaks volumes. You know, you don't really need to go into the details of that. You have captured all the details in very minimalistic kind of strokes, if I'm right.
Yeah.
Now I'll open it out to the house. Anybody who has questions?
Thank you for a fascinating talk, and you know, how you've shown the evolution of your work is something to me that seems as if it's always your mind's eye that has been sort of put there on the canvas. But I just wanted to ask you, in your demeanor and the way you talk, and you know what we perceive of you, is a very gentle, very perceptive kind of a person. Yes, perceptions are already reflected there. But why did you choose such disturbing subjects, such as, you know, violent deaths, and you know, the entrails of a dead person, or a violently killed or murdered person, or whatever, in your paintings? I mean, when you look back upon your work, don't you find it disturbing?
So the gentleness is obviously deceptive. I agree with you that the gentleness is deceptive. Okay, I've been asked this question again and again, and you know, you're right to ask it. I've got the Mahabharata to back me up. In the Mahabharata, Yudhishthir is in the forest, and he's dying of thirst, and he sees a lake, and he goes there to drink. And just as he's about to take the water, he hears a voice which says, before you can touch this water, you have to answer three questions. I forget what the first two questions are, because I'm so fascinated by the last one. The question is, what is the strangest thing in the world? And Yudhishthir says, the strangest thing in the world is that human beings see death and dying all around them, and yet they feel that it doesn't refer to themselves. So I think that these paintings refer to ourselves, to myself certainly, and to you also, and all of us. And that is good enough reason to address the subject.
You know, it's not about the themes of your paintings or drawings. It's about actually the palette. I want to ask you a question. What struck me really was your palette and the way you apply color. Looks like you deliberately take away the luminosity of color. It occurred to me. And there's a certain graininess. You know, it's almost like poster colors or like you know, pastel colors, crushed and, you know, kind of used in some way. is my perception
right.
in some way right. relevant for the work you do,
yeah,
or is it
yeah.
my perception?
You're right. To some extent, it's the reproduction on the screen that is to blame. But that's not the whole story. I agree with you that I do consciously suppress some color. Often that is done in order to offset another area which is very vibrant, so that the two can speak to each other. And I hope that in some of the paintings, you know, it might have been obvious. I think in some of the well painting is more obvious than others. Even in the battered man in the landscape, the landscape is very, very pastely, as you say. But the blood clots oozing from his neck are brilliant red, you know. So it is a process of counterpointing color. The other answer I have is that yes, sometimes I do control. It's because I don't like to shout.
I felt that there's you know, a keen clinical precision in your paintings. Does it have something to do with you having, you know, been a doctor? Is it that, or is it just
okay,
you know, have passed away? Yeah.
Well, again, I mean, it's a question I'm often asked to answer. Thank you. My answer, I don't know how far it's an honest answer, but my answer is that I sometimes feel that even were I not a doctor, were I not trained to be a medical practitioner, I might still have wanted to paint these subjects, and I might still have wanted to paint them with a certain amount of precision. Maybe the answer, I mean, in fact, struck me just the other day, you know, sometimes while one is having a shower, things come to you. And in the middle of the shower, it suddenly remembered that among the various grammar exercises that one was given in school, the one that I enjoyed the most was the précis, you know, where you are given two pages to read of a passage. And then the teacher said, make a précis of five lines. And I really used to enjoy that. And I used to get very good marks for it. In five lines, I would need to encapsulate what those two pages had said. And to encapsulate with accuracy and with fullness of communication. I think that temperamentally, perhaps, I like that, you know. I like to be able to say something in five words, if one can say that with as much clarity and passion as, then why write two pages?
I think आपका इतिहास कभी आपका पीछा नहीं छोड़ता है नहीं द नॉलेज ऑफ समबडीज अदर वोकेशन ऑलवेज ट्रिगर्स सम काइंड ऑफ थॉट्स बिकॉज एज अ पोएट ऑल्सो लाइक समबडी राइट्स अ ग्रंथ यू नो इन ऑर्डर टू कम्युनिकेट सम आइडिया बट अ पोएट सेज इन अ फ्यू लाइन्स मे बी इट इज विद इन यू एज अ पर्सन
Gieve, my interest really is to ask you, because being a painter and knowing you for so many years, I think it's also interesting to look at how our generation contextualizes us, isn't it? So when I look at your work, I was having this conversation with a friend the other day, that everything in some ways gets contextualized, and then who we are and what our personal politics is and how we view the outer world of existence, then we place ourselves. And I think that when I look at you and I see your work, I think maybe it'd be interesting to hear you say a little bit about that, how you have been contextualized by the India that you live in. by the location that you are existing in. You often talk, and most of your work is about your existence in Mumbai, and I'm sure, of course, other aspects of observation to India. But I'm interested to hear a little bit about that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the question, Rekha. And you know, Rekha and I, we've known each other for many years, and we are very familiar with each other's work. So it's delightful to have her here and to get a question from her. Thank you. You're right, you know, none of us exists out of a context. You know, we are, whether we are artists or scientists or any other kind of worker, you know, we are born at a certain time. There have been people before us who worked, there are people after us who will work, and we have our colleagues. And that shapes our work, most certainly. The historical part of the answer, I'll have to think about it a little bit, but let me answer it in terms of my positioning myself among my fellow artists. The generation before mine, are the people like Akbar Padamsi and Tayyab Mehta, whose work I admire greatly. Their work did not make a direct reference to day-to-day Indian life, as some of my work does, or some of Sudhir Patwardhan, Bhupen Kakkar, Ghulam Ahmad Sheikh, people of my generation. So Akbar and Tayyab's work, they had human figures, but they were iconic human figures. They were universalized human figures, you know. They are not humans, people who live in Bombay or people who live in Baroda. They are people who live in the imagination of the human race, you know. And so there's a certain kind of work. Now, my compatriots like Bhupen Kakkar and Sheikh were very uncomfortable with this kind of work because they felt very strongly the need to address local reality. That man in the bazaar in Baroda is my subject matter, not some human being from the imagination, however lofty that imagination may be, right? So I also participated in, I was very sympathetic to Akbar and Tayyab's work, but I also participated in the work of my generation. You know, so like in a way, I fall happily between two stools. I'm equally comfortable with Akbar and Tayyab and with Ghulam and Bhupen. And this is again a matter of temperament, perhaps, a matter of history, of friendships, of whatever. So this positions me in terms of my relationship with my compatriots. In relation to history, or Indian history particularly, you're putting me a very tough one. I don't really know if I have an answer to that. Maybe somebody else needs to answer it. But I'll give it thought.
I have a question, like the kind of vocabulary, the visual vocabulary you have created. Can you give us a little bit of a hint of how, although it's very difficult, but how did you arrive at the vocabulary? It's very distinct and different, you know, and especially having been a self-taught artist. And is there any linkage between the way you conceive your ideas in your poetry, you put across your thoughts in your poems? Is there any linkage between these two?
So there's two questions. I'll address the first one, Devan, thank you. Over the last few years, more and more, I've been hearing this from people. It's not something that I've invented. I've been hearing this from critics, from visitors from abroad, from my fellow artists. They say that what they find of interest in my work is the fact that although I may be painting a head or a peacock or a tree trunk. They say it is a head or a peacock or a tree trunk, but they say that it is also an abstract work. And they seem to be fascinated by the marriage of a complete abstraction to a complete realistic moment. Now, to what extent am I as a painter, artist, aware of this? I don't think I have been ever, aware of it in the sense of telling myself, okay, now I will do a work which is realistic and abstract at the same time. That would have been the end of it, And if you set yourself mechanical tasks of this kind, you'll end in disaster. I have worked intuitively where a subject leads me. And I just happened to arrive, the most, I think, telling is the clouds, isn't it? I mean, they are extremely abstract. And at the same time, they are clouds. I would hate that anybody should say that they're not clouds. To me, they're clouds, If somebody were to tell me that these are abstract paintings, I'd be a bit disappointed, In the same way, I was very, very amazed that peacock at Nariman Point. When I was looking at the painting of the, I was looking at the photograph of the peacock, and then I had several Indian miniatures where the peacock is portrayed, and I was looking very carefully at that, and I was constructing my own peacock, and I thought I'd got a damn good peacock which looks like a peacock. My friend Anju Dodia, when she visited my studio, she said, oh, this is wonderful, She says, it's so abstract. And I didn't know whether to be disappointed or whether to be happy. But again, like with the potato, since I knew that Anju admired the painting, I was consoled.
The city has had the opportunity of having some of the most subtle moments being, described on this very stage, be it Akbar Padamsi or Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh or Sudhir Patwardhan, even Subodh or Jitish. Many of these people have come in here, and today another great, I wouldn't describe it as a giant, because giant seems very, very unfriendly kind of a word, but a towering figure in the field of visual arts of the country, and in the I would say shape and this thing of in the presence of Mr. Dr. Gieve Patel in front of us, and we are so very thankful. I'm not ending it here because there's another question by Dr. N.S. Ratan already there, because we are not in a great time to wind up, because I think a small number of interested gathering what we have today, I think we are keen to listen to you as much as you are willing to share with us. Thank you.
We have seen and heard Gieve Patel as a painter and sculptor, but we have not tasted any part of Patel as a poet. So I would request if we could get some taste of his poetry as well.
Thank you very much. I would have loved to. I would have read several poems, but I have not brought the books with me. However, if one of you has a computer, you could download this poem, which is called On Killing a Tree, which is taught to school children and is very easily available on the computer. And I'll be very happy to read it.
In fact, I too wanted to ask this thing, but I knew during the day we had asked the same question, and he I think he's done it knowingly, not bringing, because I think you had a design behind not bringing.
Deliberately did it
because you didn't. I think he had a design behind not bringing his books, because he must have been haunted by the poets and poetry lovers everywhere. So he probably, and rightly so, because we want him to come again as a poet. And so that we can have a longer session with him. Because we had actually originally planned a workshop with him. And also a dialogue with Ranjit Hoskote. And originally that was the idea, but now recently, unfortunately, Ranjit Hoskote lost his mother, and so we couldn't have him here now. But in the future, if Gieveji also agrees, then we'll have that session as well, apart from the poetry session. In the meantime, if there is any other question.
I noticed a lot of distortion, either it is in terms of color or in terms of form. I want to know, what is the role of distortion in displaying your emotions and feelings?
Okay, thank you. That's a nice question. Every artist is confronted with this dilemma or question in his own mind, that he wants to show the world in his art, in all its complexity. But the world is too huge and too complicated, and the artist is very small before it. And so the only thing that an artist can do is that he can select things from the world, a few things, and hope that by addressing a small part of the world, he will be implying something bigger. He'll be giving you a route to something bigger, right? Now, even that small thing which he takes is a problem. Because supposing an artist is interested in an apple, right? And he's got a canvas. Whatever he does, he will never be able to reproduce that apple. Because that apple is an apple and the canvas is a flat surface. Or even if he's a sculptor, that apple is an apple, it has its flesh, it has its taste. And if he makes a sculpture and paints it, it will still never, never be that apple. So an artist in that sense is bound to fail. He's destined to fail, right? So then, what is the second best thing that he can do? He can create another world. He can give up the idea of trying to show you the world as it is, because he'll never succeed. But he can create a companion world which has its own laws, which is totally different from the laws of the world as we know it, and which is the world of art. That is why the world of art has laws which belong only to itself. And those laws don't apply to external reality. And that is why an artist is not compelled to show you an apple exactly as the apple looks. By the laws of this alternative world, an apple could look like a cloud. You know? And that is what we call distortion. However, one can question this. One need not let it go scot-free. And I'll tell you a very amusing story to illustrate what I mean by questioning it. Because an artist has a right to create an alternative world, because an artist has rules and laws by which he can create an alternative world, it doesn't mean that he can do anything he likes. Nisim Ezekiel, poet and art critic and a very dear friend of mine, who died about 10 years ago, but I'm talking now in about like the year 67, 68, when we were friends in Bombay, and he occasionally used to review, and then sometimes, you know, we'd exchange stories about exhibitions and reviews. And he says, one day he came to me and he says, I really can't understand this. So I said, what can't you understand, Nisim? He said, you know, I mean, I go to this exhibition, you know, and there's this nice artist and very lovely woman, you know, and she's done these heads, you know, some of them are like that, some of them are like that, you know. And when I ask her, but why is this head looking like that, you know? She says, it's the crisis of modern man. Now, you know, this is humbug. And unfortunately, you know, I mean, this is a very, very simple example of a poor, well-meaning artist who didn't know how to get there. But there are worse examples than this of people who are very sharp and very clever and who will still give you their own version of this or that, you know. But, so then what is a viewer to make of it? The viewer has to cultivate his own sensibility to such an extent that he can stand before a work of art and say that this distortion is legitimate, but this one is not. In order to get to that point where you can say that, you have to have seen a lot of art, both in reproductions and in actual fact, and the art of various countries, and the art of various centuries, until you get so finely tuned yourself that, you know, you're like a musical instrument. When you see a work of art, something in you goes tung, 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 and it tells you, ye besur hai. Or something else tells you, wah, ye kya sound hai.
The poem is there on a slightly bigger screen and more visible.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Oh, this looks like something I can read. Yeah, yeah. And if I want to go down, I just do that, right? Okay, the poem is called On Killing a Tree. It takes much time to kill a tree. Not a simple jab of the knife will do it. It has grown, slowly consuming the earth, rising out of it, feeding upon its crust, absorbing years of sunlight, air, water, and out of its leprous hide, sprouting leaves. So hack and chop. But this alone won't do it. Not so much pain will do it. The bleeding bark will heal, and from close to the ground will rise curled green twigs, miniature boughs, which if unchecked will expand again to former size. No, the root is to be pulled out of the earth. Out of the anchoring earth, it is to be roped, tied, and pulled out, snapped out, or pulled out entirely, out from the earth cave, and the strength of the tree exposed, the source white and wet, the most sensitive, hidden for years inside the earth. Then the matter of scorching and choking in sun and air, browning, hardening, twisting, withering, and then it is done.
I think on this note we should end this evening. And it's such an ironic thing that many of you would not know that Gieve Patel does not carry a mobile phone. He does not keep a mobile phone. He refuses to keep a mobile phone. Even yesterday he wanted to call his daughter. he was trying to call from the landline. I said, I have a spare mobile phone with a spare SIM, and for one day maybe you can. He said, no, I wouldn't. I'll wait for another day to call my daughter, but not. But today, he's reading the poem out of this machine, which is...
So, Devan, technology has caught up with me.
Yeah. And secondly, how contemporary you are.
Yes.
Even without keeping a mobile phone, how, with what ease and, you know, you've been able to use it.
Right.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you,
for sharing these moments with us.
Thank you.
They are going to stay with the city forever. In fact, you have added a new chapter to the city by accepting our invitation and having come in here and share your thoughts and ideas, and of course the wonderful work you have created in the poem. And I'm sure, God willing, if you also have the time, we would definitely have you here soon with a workshop and with a poetry session and another session with Ranjit Hoskote and many others. And we all, I thank you on behalf of the city of Chandigarh, city which has been created by one of the best architects of the world, Le Corbusier. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd love to come again.
Thank you. Thank you for accepting the invitation.